The following is a class from the Bhagavad Gita as it is, 3rd chapter, text number 8 through 13, given by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, recorded in the summer of 1966 in New York.
So, we are discussing that everybody should walk Niyatam kuru karma tam karma jayu yakarmana sarira yatra apita te na prasiddheta karmana yajnyartha karmana annatravu lukayam karma bandhana tadartham karma kauntiya mukta sanga samachare. Now this is the formula of spiritual realization, that we should not stop our working capacity, the prescribed duties in which we are engaged, that is not to be stopped. If we stop work and spiritual realization for spiritual realization, we leave this world and go to the jungle or Himalaya and sit down there for meditation, for spiritual realization. Oh, how many people will be ready to do this thing? No. This is not for mass people. Lord Sri Krishna is prescribing something practical which can be adopted by every one and all without any distinction. This point we have already discussed in the last day's meeting, that whatever you make, it doesn't matter. You can realize the highest perfection of life, provided you work under the regulation of yajna, yajnartha karma. There is no harm working, but the work should be done for the Supreme Lord, yajna. Yajna means Vishnu. Because according to laws of nature, any work you do, it has got some reaction, and we are bound up by those reactions. The Vedas also says, karmana bandhate jantu. The all living entities, they are bound up in this material encasement on account of their different kinds of karma or work. But here is the point, that you shall not be bound up by the reaction of your karma if you act it on behalf of yajna or Vishnu or the Supreme Lord. That is the secret. Yajnyartha karmana annatra. Annatra. If you do not work for that supreme purpose, then you will be bound up. And your this engagement of body will continue. This engagement of body will continue if you work on your own responsibility and not for the supreme purpose or the supreme Lord, yajna or Vishnu. That is the secret. Yajna means yajna vai Vishnu, it is sute. Sute. Sute means the Vedic literature, the Vedic hymns. They prove it. Yajna means Vishnu. Vishnu tosartham karma samachara. Therefore, we have to work for the satisfaction of Vishnu. That is called yajna. Sahajagda praja sushta purovata prajapati anera prasavidhasya. anena prasavishadhya mesa bo asti itta kamaguk. The proof of the sacrifice, yagya, is mentioned in the Vedic scripture. After the creation, it was so announced that if you want to be happy, you must perform sacrifice. Sacrifice. The Vedic literature is created for guidance of the conditioned souls. Every living being who is in this material world is conditioned by the laws of material nature. And it is a chance that this creation, and especially this human body, is a chance to get rid of this material entanglement. And the chance is open by acting for the satisfaction of Vishnu. Kaho jagda praja sishta. Praja, praja means the living entities, after being created, they were advised that you perform yagya or sacrifice for the satisfaction of Vishnu. That way, anena, by this, prasavishadhya, you increase your enlightenment, prasavishadhya, and whatever you want, that will be satisfied by this yagya. Devan yagya, that sacrifice. Devan bhavatanena ti deva bhavayantu parasparam bhavayanta sreya param abhartata. Now, yagya is practically, according to the Vedic rituals, yagya or sacrifice is offered to different devas, demigods. There are hundreds and thousands of demigods mentioned in the Vedic literature. And the whole portion is called Upasana Kanda. Upasana Kanda means worshipping different demigods. But what are these demigods? The demigods are just like different parts of the whole body of the Supreme Lord. They are, so to say, just like the government of the king. There is one king, but there are many state officers. Just you can imagine that if for management of a city like New York, you have got so many departments. As soon as we go to this chamber, we get so many departments, criminal departments, civil departments, and so many departments. So, for management of this universal affair, there are different departments also. So far you can get information from the Vedic literature. And each department, there is a particular director. And Brahma is considered to be supreme director of this universe. So, this yagya, sacrifice, right, Vedic rituals, they are indicated to pay different taxes to different demigods. But the Supreme Lord is above all. Therefore, if one performs sacrifice for the Supreme Lord, he is immune for other obligations. That is also meant. Devarsi bhutatminam pitrinam nayam kinkara rinita rajan sarvatmanada saranam sarannam gatu mukundam parihuttukattum. Now, as soon as a living being is born in this material world, he has got many obligations. he has got obligation to the different demigods. Why obligation? Now because just like the sun is also one of the demigods, he is supplying you light, so you have got some obligation. Don't you have any obligation? If you have got obligation to the electric powerhouse for supplying this light which you are enjoying now, have you got no obligation to the sun who is supplying so much profusely light? Yes, you have got. The Vedic literature confirms it, that you are indebted to the sun. Similarly, you are indebted to the moon. Similarly, you are indebted to air and so many things that taking advantage of the supernatural power. So, we are actually indebted. Similarly, we are indebted to the rishis, great sages, because they have left behind them all this Vedic knowledge. You are taking advantage. Just like this Bhagavad Gita or any scripture, any book of knowledge. So, we are indebted. Deva, Rishi and Bhuta. Bhuta means ordinary, general living beings in our dealing. Suppose if I go to consult some lawyer, I have to pay. If I want to consult some medical practitioner, I have to pay. So this is obligation. This is no mercy, this is obligation. Similarly, we are obliged in so many respects to the supernatural power, to the sages, to the ordinary living beings, and to the animals also. Because we are drinking milk from the cows, so we are indebted. But instead of paying our indebtedness, we are killing. These are all reactions. They are creating reactions. If you don't pay bill for electricity for many long time, your electricity will be cut off. Your telephone will be cut off. But we must be conscious of our indebtedness to so many things. Devarsi bhutartha ninang pitrinang. Pitrinang means the family in which you have taken your birth. You are indebted to the forefather. Therefore, according to Vedic rite, in certain time, you have to offer respect to your forefather, Sraddha ceremony. During the month of October, there is general Sraddha ceremony in India. So we are indebted to the forefather. Devasi bhuta tuminang pitrinang. So we are in so many ways indebted. Our obligations are there. But sarvātmanāja saranaṁ saranaṁ gatū mukundam nā sārini nā kinkara. The Bhāgavat says, if somebody fully surrenders unto the Supreme Mukunda, Mukunda means one who can offer you liberation from this material bondage, he is Mukunda. So if one surrenders fully unto Krishna, Krishna is Mukunda, then he is no longer anymore indebted to all these obligations. He is innocent. At one stroke, he becomes liquidated from all obligations. And in the Bhagavad Gita you'll find this statement, confirmed in the last portion of Bhagavad Gita. The Lord says that Ahantam Sarvapapibha Mukhvaishyami. If you surrender unto me, Sarvadhanman Parityajya, Mamekam Saranam Gajya, the Lord says, that you have to do nothing. You simply surrender unto me. Sarvadhanman Parityajya. You have got so many obligations, it is right. But it is impossible for you. Of course, there are systems how to liquidate your obligation. But especially in this age, who is going to satisfy the demigods, who is going to satisfy the four tadas, who is going to satisfy the so many obligations of ordinary living beings? Nobody is going. But if you don't satisfy your indebtedness, then there will be reaction. But if you surrender unto the Supreme Lord, you will be protected from all evil. Therefore, it is very easy. By one installment, we become free from all obligations. The sarva-dhanman parityajya, mamekam saranam gaja, ahantam sarva-papibha. Papibha means the reaction of sins. Now, if I don't repay my indebtedness to the person to whom I am obliged, then I have become sinner. I am sinner. Just like I owe to you $100 or $1,000, I don't pay you. So then I become a culprit in the consideration of the state law. No, I have to pay you. Similarly, all indebtedness has to be liquidated. If you are unable to liquidate, then you will be a sinner. But you can save yourself from the reaction of all sins if you surrender unto the Supreme Lord. Sarvatmanaja saranam saranam gato mukundam parihirtu kattum. You have got some duty, but if you give up all your duty and simply surrender unto the Supreme Lord, then you are liquidated at once. This is the version of Bhagavad, and this is confirmed in Bhagavad Gita by the Supreme Personality of God as Sri Krishna, that if you surrender unto me, giving up all your other obligations, then I shall give you all protection. Aṃ sarva pāpibha mukhvaishyāmi. Now, if I am protected from the reaction of my sinful act, but it does not mean that I shall surrender unto the Supreme Lord at the same time continue to act sinfully. No. Not that. Or if I am obliged to continue, the God or the Supreme Lord will protect me. That is the point. Therefore, everyone should act jagga. Jagga means work to satisfy the Supreme Lord. That is called jagga. If you do not do that, then we shall be obliged. Otherwise, when the act which is done for the satisfaction of the Supreme Lord, that is immune from all reaction. But anything which is not done for the satisfaction of the Supreme Lord, that will oblige me in so many bondage of obligation, and I'll have to repay that after many, many continuation of this repetition of birth and death. That is the secret of our life. So, devan bhavatanena, ti deva bhavayantava, parasparam bhavayanta sriyam param avasati. And if you live your life for sacrifice of jagga, then you will never be unhappy. You will never be in want. We become unhappy for want of things which is required. This is practical. which is practical. Anyone, you'll be surprised. I have taken practical information. In 1942, there was a manufactured famine in Bengal by the manipulation of the then government. It is for the first time we experienced that India, in our childhood, when we were children, at that time, the first class rice was selling $3 for 82 pounds. Can you imagine? $3. Not $3, I mean to say, dollar is exchanged, say for less than $1, $3/4. 3 rupees, the exchange of dollar and rupees is 5 rupees, make $1. Now it was selling at 3/8. So about, 75 cents for 82 pounds of best rice. I have seen it in my experience in my life when I was born in India, it was said. Can you imagine that? But that rice, all of a sudden, rose in 1940, $10. Now just imagine, if something, the price of something is raised from 75 cents to $10, how difficult it becomes for the public, for general mass of people. So many people were in difficulty and so many people died for want of food, diseases, because when there is want of food. But you'll be surprised, I inquired, in 1942, persons who were in our line, I mean to say, engaged in devotional service. I also partake at the same time. I had in my family life at that time, I had some responsibility. Myself, my wife, my 5 children, servant, and so many, about 10 people. And I was purchasing rice. So, anyway, management was going on. But so many people died. But you'll be surprised. Those were and in somewhere other, in touch with the devotional service, I inquired from them individually and I was satisfied that they were not in difficulty. Even in that famine happening. Even from the villages I inquired that were you in difficulty, they replied, no, we have no difficulty, somewhere or other, we are managing. So this is practical. Anyone who is engaged in the devotional service, whose life is dedicated for service of the Supreme, will see practically that there will be no want, there will be no unhappiness. This is a fact. This is a fact. Divan bhavatanena ti deva bhavantava parasparam bhavasyam paramavartata. This is Vedic injunction. The injunction is also like that. That you do sacrifice for the Supreme. Then we'll never be unhappy. We'll never be in want. Now mind that the work is not stopped. The work in which you are engaged, that is not stopped. We have discussed in the previous verse that Niyata Purukamata. The work which is entrusted to you or the work in which you are now engaged, that is not to be abandoned. You work as you are doing. But you engage the result of your work or life for the matter of sacrificing for the Supreme Lord. There is a very good example in the life of the Goswamis, whom we daily pray, Bande Rupa Sanatanam Raghujagau Sri Jiva Gopalako. These six Goshamins, they are very important men of their age, in 500 years before. These Rupa and Sanatan, they are great politicians, ministers of the then Mohammedan government in Bengal. In Bengal, at that time, the Pathans were ruling. Before the Mughals came, there were Pathan ruling. For 1,000 years, the Mohammedans invaded India from 1000 AD up to 1947, till the end of the British period. India was under subjugation by so many foreigners, Mohammedans, Greeks, and so many others. Lastly, the Mohammedans ruled for 800 years, and the British has ruled for 200 years. So now they have got independence, India. At that time, the Bengal was being ruled by the Mohammedans, Pathans, and their entrusted ministers were these Rupa and Sanatan. They were converted into practically Mohammedan. Hindu society was very strict at that time. Still they are very strict. Anyone serving a foreigner, he becomes at once ostracized. He is at once, rejected from the social intercourse. So these brothers, Rupa and Sanatan, because they accepted Mohammedan and ruler's service as minister, they were outcast from the they were actually Brahmins by caste. Somewhere or other, these Rupa and Sanatan contacted Lord Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and they retired from their service and joined. And after all, they became the most important leaders of this movement, Rupa and Sanatan. So now, this Rupa and Sanatan, when they retired from their service, they brought home gold coins. At that time, there was no currency notes. Actual value, gold coins were in. Now that gold coin was about 2.5 ounce weight. Just like imagine what is the value now, whatever it may. That means the estimation is some millions of rupees brought home after their retirement. And they divided the money in this way. 50% for God. Whatever they accumulated, they set aside 50% for God or God's service. God means God's service. God is not want of your money. He is quite competent to earn money. He doesn't require anything. But if we give, it is our interest. It is our interest. So he set aside 50% of his accumulated money for God, 25% for the relatives, family members, and 25% he kept in some village banker or the original bankers for emergency. So that was the system we can see from great sages and acharyas. That whatever we earn, they according to Bhagavad Gita, it is said, jagnyartha karma nasa. Whatever you want, jat karo si jat jo si. The result of your work should be offered to the Supreme. Now, if it is not possible to offer the whole thing to the Supreme, so at least one should offer 50% of his income for God's purpose. That is the example we get from these acharyas. So, 50% for God 25%, of course, the relatives, they expect something from the father or the chief of the family, expect something. But according to this Acharya ruling, the gift was only 25%. Not that whatever money I have got, I leave to my family and go single-handed to God. If God asks you what you have sacrificed for me, you have come to me. No, sir, I have sacrificed everything for my family. That is not good. That is not yajna. Yajna means, now, if you cannot spare your money separately for God's service, then you can engage yourself in God's service and expend the money for God's service. Don't offer your money in others' hands, but you spend yourself for God's cause. That will make you perfect. Yajna Sukarma. That is explained in the next sloka. Ishtan bhogan hi bodeva dasante yajnabhavita tai dattan pradayebhya jo bhungte sena evasa. But ishtan bhogan, whatever you have got for your subsistence, you should know it is given by God. Now, say for example, these grains. The grains, they are given to you by God for eating. You cannot manufacture grain in your factory. You have manufactured or set up so many factories for manufacturing tools, machinery, motor cars, and so many other things for your comfort. But there is not a single factory in the whole world which can manufacture wheat, rice, grains or vegetables or something like that. So we should consider that these foodstuffs which we eat daily, they are produced by God's mercy or they are given by God. Istan bhogani bodhiva. God or God's agent, whatever it may be. Taidattan, and if you take from, even you produce from your land, that is also God's mercy. Because for agriculture, for example, if there is no rain, you cannot produce anything. Now, rain, you have no control over rain. We shall come to that point in the next sloka. But if you perform yajnas rightly, you will have got, sufficient rains to produce everything. Maharaj Yudhishthira's reign, his kingdom, his government, was conducted in that way. Profusely, the nature was producing profusely. How profusely he was benefited by nature's gift, that is stated in the Bhagavad. I shall recite that verse before you and explain to you. Next. So, Ishtan bhogani deva dasante yajnabhavita. If you perform the sacrifice, then your necessities will be supplied profusely by the agents of the Supreme Lord. The mind that always, that we are not going to be idle. We shall go on with our work as we are doing. But at the same time, we must perform yajnas or sacrifice for the Supreme. Then we will have sufficient for our necessities. And now, after having sufficient of our necessities, if we don't acknowledge or don't give the taxes, or obligation, feel our obligation, then he said, Tvai dattan pradayebhya. Now God or God's agent is supplying so many things, and if you do not acknowledge or repay by sacrifice, then what is your position? Jo bhunte, one who enjoys, tena eva sa, he is a thief. He is a thief, therefore punishable. As a thief is punishable by the state law. Similarly, one who takes advantage of this natural facilities and do not acknowledge it and do not offer sacrifice to the Supreme, then he is considered to be a thief. It is said in the Bhagavad Gita. Tena eva. The jagyasishta sino santya muchyante sarvakilmasi. So, we are becoming debtors and debtors life after life in this way. And the only way to liquidate our so many debts is to perform jagga. Now, there are different rituals of jagga. If we want to perform such jaggas for sacrificing clarified butter, grains, there are different so many kinds of jagga. It is not possible in this age. For this age, the particular type of sacrifice which is recommended, we had some sample of it yesterday in our this law. Jagdai sankirtanai prayai jajantehi sumedhata. In this age, it is very difficult to perform all those rituals. First thing, it is very difficult to obtain all the ingredients for sacrificing method, and people are not very well-to-do. They cannot secure also. The symptoms of the people of this age is also described. Prayena alpuayusa sabhya kalavasmin jugi jana. Prayena, in this age, people are generally short living. They are not living for more than 60 or 70 years. Formerly, they were living more than 100 years. Gradually, their duration of life is decreasing. And it is stated also that it will decrease to such an extent that any man who is living from 20 to 30 years, he will be considered a very old man. That is also stated in the Bhagavad. Of course, that is not yet come, but it will come in this age. So, the symptoms of the people of this age are described that people are of very short life. Pāyena alpāyāyusa sabhya kalavasmin jugidhana mandā. And they are very lazy and slow. Slow and lazy means that they do not know that this life is meant for spiritual realization. So they are very lazy. All life, spiritual realization, you shall see later on. Let us enjoy life, that's all. So this is a great disqualification of the human being, that they are not wake up for spiritual realization. Lazy, manda. And manda bhagya, manda samanda matayo. And if somebody is at all interested for some spiritual enlightenment, then unfortunately, manda samanda, they adopt some spiritual method which is not recognized. Spiritual realization with relationship with God is no spiritual realization. The whole spiritual realization means one must understand his relationship with the Supreme Lord. But generally, in these days, they want to avoid the conception of God, and at the same time they want to be spiritually advanced. That what they are called Sumanna Matai. A very degraded form of spiritual realization without concession of God. Sumanna Matayo, Mandas, lazy, and if they are at all interested in some spiritual realization process, they try to avoid the conception of God. Sumanna Matayo. And Mandabhagya means unfortunate. People of this age, mostly, they are not very fortunate. In any part of the world, they are not very fortunate. They do not get things, desirable things, very easily. Our desirable things are four things for living purposes. Ahara, nidra, vayamaitunam. Eating, sleeping, and defense, and mating. These are our, generally, so far as our body is concerned. So these things are also not easily available. Samandha, samandha matayo, mandha bhagya, upadhruta, and at the same time, in spite of all these disqualifications, they are always disturbed in mind. Why disturbed? Now that roga soka adhi, for some lamentation and for some disease. So this is the condition of the people of this age, and it is very difficult for them to follow the system of sacrifice which was being performed in the older days. Now, for them, in these days, Lord Chaitanya recommended this sacrifice, this Sankirtan Jagra, which we are trying to perform here. Sankirtan Jagnai Sankirtanai Prahi Jajanti Ismenasa. Now, those who have got better bread, they will adopt this process of Sankirtan Jagga for satisfaction of the Supreme Lord. That way, very helpful for the men of this age. That is recommended in Bhagavatam. Now, either you adopt this Jagga or that Jagga according to your capacity. But you must have to perform Jagga. Without Jagga, you cannot be happy. Jagyasistha sino santa muchyante sarvakim sai bhunyante te adhang papa je pachyanti atmakaranat. Now, pachyanti atmakaranat means cooking. The cooking is the most important business of our life. Cooking, nobody is human being. We are not cats and dogs, and every human being has to cook things for eating. Now this eating process, the Lord says that one who takes the eatables after the sacrifice, then he becomes free from all kinds of sinful reactions. And one who cooks for himself, for enjoyment, then he eats all kinds of sins. Jagnasistha sina santa. Santa, santa means saints and sages. They do not take anything without offering jagga. At least whenever you take something, if you offer the same thing to the Lord, my Lord, it is by your grace I have got this eatable. You kindly accept it and I shall take the remnant. This is jagga. This is also jagga. So just yesterday we prepared some food cooperatively and offered to Lord and performed sankirtan and we took it. This is the simplest process of performing jagga. Because we require food. So, this was done here in this loft as a matter of example. But you can do it in your home also. Because you are cooking for your children, for yourself, for your wife, for family members. Now if you cook nicely, things which are to be offered to the Lord, of course we must be careful to prepare foodstuff, because we are going to offer to the Lord, and we must offer things which is acceptable by the Lord. At least, of course, Lord can accept anything and everything. He is quite competent. He is all-powerful, almighty. But still, in the Bhagavad Gita, it is said, the Lord says, patram puspam phalam toyam jomi bhakta prajacchati. Anyone who gives me these four things, patram puspam phalam toyam, that means grains, vegetables, and flowers, fruits, all these things, anyone who offers me, I take them. Offers with taya bhakta upuritam, with devotion. Not that God is hungry and therefore He is hankering after your offering of foodstuff. No, He is quite competent. He has got many things to eat. It is practically His things we are eating. But still, if we prepare foodstuff in that way and offer to the Supreme Lord, then after offering if we take, then we become free from all sinful reactions. That is stated here. Jagdashishtasinavasanta muchyante. Muchyante means he becomes liberated, freed from. What is that? Sarvakirmi sai, all kinds of sinful reactions. That's it. But one who does not do so, bhunjante te abhang papa, they must be eating only sins. Only sin. So we have to suffer the sinful reaction also. Dipachyante atmakarma. But the thing is, now, it is very easy. What? You are going to the store, just like yesterday, a day before yesterday, Mr. Karl and Mr. Paul went to some store. Oh, tomorrow it will be jagga. But things are purchased. With the purpose of person. The same thing we are purchasing from the store, but we are thinking, I shall eat. That if you transfer that epithet only, that this is, we are purchasing things for God's eating. So there is no loss on your part, but you perform yoga. You perform yoga. This practice has to be done. Jagdashishtasinosanta muchyante sarvakirmi. If you practice these simple things, then you become free from all sinful reactions. And if you don't do this, then what happens? Na bhunyante te adhang papa. One who does not do this, he eats only sinful reactions and he has to pay for that. He has to suffer for that. Pachyante atmakarma. He has no relation with the Jagga or Vishnu. But he thinks that I shall eat. So the beginning of the process of Jagga in this age can be very easily done by everyone. Either he is family man or single man or anything. Everyone has to cook for himself. Now that cooking may be done for the Supreme Lord, and after cooking the foodstuff, offer it to the Supreme Lord and perform this jagga, sankirtan, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare, then you become free from all sinful. After all, whatever we are doing, we are committing some sort of, even unknowingly. There are recommendations on these babies, pancha jagga. Pancha jagga means that unknowingly we are killing many living entities. Suppose when you are walking on the street, there are many ants who are being killed on the pressure of our shoes. So that is also counted as sin. In God's kingdom, in God's state. Just like here, you have to pay by your life if you kill one man. If you commit a murder, you have to repay this murdering sin by your own life. That is, of course, an imperfect law, man-made law. Similarly, in God's law also, if you kill any living entity, you have to suffer for that. Because in the God's eyes, there is no question of man or animal or ant or fly or something like that. Every living entity is the son of God. Now suppose your father has got 5 sons. One of them is worthless, is doing nothing. And if the other son says, my dear father, this son, your youngest son or this son is worthless, is doing nothing, let us kill him. Will your father agree? Because he is worthless, will your father agree? No. He will say, no. You have nothing to do. He is not harming you. He is eating my subsistence. I am paying for his subsistence. Why you should kill him? Similarly, in this material nature, all these living entities in different forms, they have come for material enjoyment. And everything is being supplied by the Supreme Law. We have no right to kill them. We have no right according to God's law. If one is conscious of the same thing, just like the father will never agree to kill a worthless child by the competent boy. No. So, consciously or unconsciously, we are committing, suppose I am not willingly killing any animal, but unconsciously I am killing so many living entities by my walking, by my so many things, they are called panchajaggas in the Vedic. So, and even if we can do not kill animals, simply by eating vegetables, they are also like. It does not mean the vegetarians are not killing. They are also killing. The law is that a living entity lives by killing other living entities. That is the law. those who have got hands, they are killing those who have got legs. Just like man is killing animals. The animal is eating the grass. Those have no legs. So this is the law. But our thing is that we have to offer yajna. Killing of animals does not mean that if a man kills a cow or goat for eating, he is killing. And those who are vegetarian, they are not killing, they are also killing. Because a vegetable has also got life. So it is not the question of killing. It is the question of offering yajna. It is a question of offering yajna. Even animal eaters and the slave eaters, they have also some process for offering yajna. In the Vedic process, in the slave eaters, they are also prescribed that you can perform yajna like this. Yajna must be there. Yajna must be there. So far, we are concerned who are going to have Krishna consciousness. We have to take the instruction of Krishna, as he says in the Bhagavad Gita. He says that patram pushpam phalam tuyam. He is asking foodstuff prepared from vegetable kingdom. Therefore, we have to prepare things from vegetable kingdom nicely and very palatably and offer Krishna and then take it. This yajna will make us free from all kinds of things and our life will be sublime. Thank you very much.